भवमज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुः उन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. नमो ॐ विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने. नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादिपाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः. जय श्रीकृष्णचैतन्यप्रभुनित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैतगदाधर श्रीवासादिगौरभक्तवृन्द. हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम 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 हरे हरे. So today we are coming to the fourth session of the Gita in a Nutshell course. So we'll repeat the first three sutras, okay? Please tell me your names again, all of you. I can recollect again from here again. Yes, Prabhuji. Yeah.
Hare Krishna. My name is Hari Prasad.
Hari Prasad from IIT Kharagpur. Yeah.
My name is Ashok Rathore. Yes. From Gwalior actually.
Yes. Yeah. Is it Dhanush?
Yes.
Okay, Dhanush. We from missed you one session, I think.
Yeah, I went outside.
Yeah. Dhanush from IIT Madras. Okay. You're from Kerala, no? Okay, and?
My name is Brijesh.
Brijesh.
Not from IIT.
Okay. which place you belong to?
UP.
Uttar Pradesh. UP, which place? UP is very big.
Gajipur.
Ah, okay. And here you're working with?
I'm working with here, John Deere.
Ah, John Deere. Who was in Aeon? Somebody was in? Ah, Aeon. Who? Not here. Eaton, yes, Eaton, okay. Yes.
My name is Nikhil Joshi. I'm from Indore. Yes. I'm working in John Deere.
Okay. They both are in John Deere, okay.
Same project.
Okay.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Ashirvad from Indore.
Yes, I remember very well.
Aditya Negi from Ghaziabad, Uttar
Pradesh. Achha, Aditya and Dhanush are same.
And Hari Prasad also.
Hari Prasad also. Okay, okay. Yeah. You are in same Prabhuji. Company. Okay.
Yeah, Prabhuji. Ajay from Varanasi, MDocs.
Yes, MDocs.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. My name is Swapnil from SAU.
Ah, very good. Swapnil, can teach them Mridangam if anybody wants to learn? See, his hands are like a Gandharva's hands. Powerfully plays Mridangam. Anybody, you have a sense of music and you have inclination, any of you here? We have already seen 3-4 of them. So this is more easy to learn. You can begin with this and then gradually we can learn that also. So we will repeat the 3 sutras we learnt, the 3 previous sessions. First session was this. Please repeat. This body is not all in all.
Soul exists.
This one lifetime is not all in all. Many more lifetimes exist.
Many more lifetimes exist.
This material world is not all in all.
There is a spiritual world.
We are not all in all.
There is a God in control.
So, last time, third session, you all remember about the material world and spiritual world. Spiritual world is like the original mango tree. Material world is like upside down tree. Huh? Therefore, the happiness is always escaping us. It's like going underwater to capture a reflection mango, which you cannot get. So we spent quite a bit of time on that. Also, we discussed about karma also, law of karma, how in this world everybody acts piously or impious, sinfully, and they reap their own fruits of their action. In this world. And the reincarnation is based on what activities you have done now. Just like you are all working in a company now, at the end of the month, the paycheck goes directly to your bank account, or you take a cash and you have to go and put it. Now it goes directly. So that is called Sanchit Karma. You have a bank account, isn't it? In that goes. And from that you take out some cash and you spend regularly. That's like a It's called Prarabdha Karma. Correct, no? You take a part of your savings
from your savings, take a part, and then you have some money in your pocket now. Right now, you all have some money in your pocket to spend every day. That is called prarabdha karma, you call it. So sanchit karma is like a big set. You have a lot. In that, right now, you are spending. And then you are also doing some work now. And then that work will bring you some results at the end of the month. Correct, no? Which will go into your bank account again. That means you are all creating fresh karma. Correct, no? Making. So we learned about all this in the previous session. And also one more thing we learned about is how the material world and spiritual world. Material world there is misery and spiritual world there is happiness. Last time I couldn't cover a few points which I will cover in this last session. And this fourth sutra is this: we are not all in all, there is a God in control. So that will become evident for you in this coming session. What happened? Oh, here, it is not connected here. Yeah, this is coming now. See, happiness is one thing that we all are looking for, is it not true? In this world, people marry because a man thinks my heart is hard. If I have a, you know, female who has some emotion, adding emotion to my life, I may become happy. Some people think like that. But after marriage, say there are tussles, problems, then they think, oh, we couldn't become happy. Maybe if you get a baby, the baby will bring us happiness. Then they get a baby. Then attention of mother and father goes towards the baby and raising the baby. And the baby is a good baby. You know, whatever mother and father says, he obeys and they're very happy. Now the baby becomes 13, 14 years old. After that, the boy tells the parents, "Tum apna dekho, main apna dekhunga." Then again, they have no happiness because they feel loss of control. Correct, no? So they wonder, then where is happiness? So now I'll be showing you what are all different things people do for happiness, you see. So this is sports. People take out time. When I was in IIT Bombay, I have seen boys playing till morning 4 o'clock, you know. So when I would be getting up in the morning to chant Hare Krishna, they would be going to sleep. That is the time. So people are mad after sports many times. Okay, people are mad after drinking, smoking and drugs. They are trying to find happiness in that. People are going for DJ, dancing. In colleges, like in one of the colleges in Pune, they said they have a Ramnami festival. They said, I said, what is Ramnami? Morning 11 o'clock, some 4 or 5 professors come together and they have a Panditji who does little puja for Sitaram. That is morning program. That only for 5-6 teachers come. And evening they said, actual Ramnami festival. I asked, what is this? This is Ramnami for them. This is a festival. They have a DJ, big loud music, rock music, boys, girls dancing. People like to find happiness like that. This is adventure. People want to do some adventure by which they can find happiness. Even in Pune, boys and girls, they go for skydiving. Skydiving means they take a parachute and try to come down from a hill. Some people try to come down without opening the parachute for some distance. Correct, no? Then in between they open and afterwards. If it doesn't open, you know what happens. People want adventure. Cheerleading. People want to keep different types of hairstyles. Basically, they want to look different from others. By looking different from others, they want to attract the attention of others. When everyone's attention is attracted, they feel happy. People are looking at me. Otherwise, normally people don't look at them. See, this fellow is a football type. This fellow's face is on the other side. Correct, no? All kinds of things people do. To become happy, what all they do, see? So, in summary, happiness means four things. You see here, happiness means people want to have improved facilities for eating. People go to some Lonavala Continental Hotel from here for eating because they have a long tongue. They want to go and enjoy. Correct, no? This is most famous one. Especially IT people, I heard that Saturday is a day they sleep a lot, except all of you. You all have come for the program. They are in Karade, they come on Saturday also, correct, no? So generally, people, when they don't have anything immediately they got to do, then what is the best thing they do generally? just sleep off. Sometimes 12 hours, 14 hours. So this is one thing people delight. Just like they delight in eating, they delight in sleeping also. Like one of my friends in IIT, he would sleep. After the exam, he slept on Friday and got up on Sunday. Huh? So I was shocked. Huh? How can somebody sleep for 2 days? Huh? So he said, I had to get up because I was hungry also, he said. Huh? So he got up. Huh? So this is another famous thing, looking for a mate. Huh? Because as I told you, these are all ways by which people look for happiness. Huh? This is defending, huh? Fighting, and defending oneself and attacking others. One delights in that also. They delight, they derive some kind of happiness. So you will find animals also, they have also friends and they also eat. You will see that. They also have fun. They have friends. So they also eat, sleep, mate and defend. Correct, no? You will see them doing. Just 1 minute. I think I have a... Why it's not connecting? Okay. Yes, it's coming here.
A group of lions ambush an elderly buffalo that has moved away from the herd. It looks like death will be the inevitable result.
See,
but a miraculous
lines.
Event takes place.
Rare to see 4 or 5 lions attacking one bull.
The elderly
buffalo.
Buffalo's cries for help reach the distant herd. They at once head for the scene. Then courageous buffaloes approach the lions in a threatening manner in order to rescue their companion.
See?
And the lions flee.
One fellow is here.
The buffalo gather around the injured animal and try to raise it to its feet. Minutes pass. Things look hopeless for the exhausted buffalo. The lions are still waiting in ambush. Believing it to have died, the last few remaining buffalo begin to move away. And yet, another miraculous event takes place. The injured buffalo cries out one more time, as if asking them not to leave it. The herd immediately come back. The buffaloes once more see off the approaching lions. With a final effort, the elderly buffalo rises to its feet, and mingling with its rescuers, is lost from sight.
See, you saw that? Which means, just like in human beings, you see them defending. In animals also you see that, isn't it? They also have feelings, they have emotions. See, we have made a comparison here, you see, eating, sleeping, mating, defending. So what's the difference? When you compare them, they do the same, like what we all do. We eat, they eat. We sleep, they sleep. We mate and produce, reproduce, and they also do. They both are common. See, they both are common. See, what is speciality of an eagle? Do you know? It has a telescopic eye. From the sky it can see something on the ground very nicely, which we can't see so far. Which means animals, birds can see better than us. Do you agree? Eagle can see better than us. What is specialty of a horse? Huh? Yeah, it can run. It's a great athlete. Huh? It can run faster than humans. What's the speciality of a dog? It can sniff and find out a thief. Can a human being sniff and find out a thief? You see, that means animals have certain powers better than humans also. Elephant, what is the speciality of an elephant? They can remember. They have very high memory. Even after, I had one video clip, I don't know where it is, but it remembers one small boy teases him. After the boy grows up, the elephant punches on his nose. You know, they have memory. They remember. This is a bear. They can sleep 6 months, polar bear. Like I told you about the boy who slept on Friday, got up on Sunday. So I told that boy, you know, if you want, you can get a polar bear's body. You can sleep 6 months in a year, they sleep. Half the year they sleep. Why I'm telling you, some of us may be proud that I can sleep for a long time, but can you imitate a polar bear? Is it possible? Yeah. This is cuckoo. What is specialty? Sweet voice, yeah. So when human being is watching all this, he understands that, oh, animals and birds are better than me in eating, sleeping, mating, defending. Like elephant can eat tons of food every day. How much can you and I eat? Correct? Like we eat in the morning, afternoon and evening 3 times a day, but cows also you will find they eat all day. Cows, bulls and all, they can keep eating all day. Elephant can eat the most big quantity. And sleeping, polar bear I told you. In mating, mosquitoes can produce millions of mosquitoes, correct, no? Like a dog can produce 2 dozen puppies in 1 year. Human being can produce how many children in 1 year? Maximum how many? Only one only. They take 9 months to... Twins. Twins, you say, okay. Maximum two. But dog can produce 2 dozen. Is it not great? So who is better in eating, sleeping, mating, defending? Who is better? They are better. If you compare them with humans. Then what is special about humans? Can any of you tell me? Then what do you think? In intelligence of a human is special, isn't it? Animals also have intelligence, don't you think? Like, for example, you keep milk in the kitchen, and you will find that the cat will walk like this with the nails to go and eat, drink the milk and go away. Why the dog is why the cat is walking with nails? No one can hear it. Do you think a cat will come inside the room and say meow and then go inside? No, it knows that it doesn't want to be driven away, so it will walk like this. That means, is it not having intelligence? It has intelligence. You will find animals for catching their prey, they have intelligence. They know. Therefore, here it is mentioned here, you see. Animals also have rational power and intelligence. In fact, animals are better than humans, but they use the rational power intelligence only for eating, sleeping, mating, defending. That's all. They don't have anything beyond that. What makes a human being different and special? Can any of you say? Think about it. They're foolish. They're foolish. Because they're more interested in eating. Because they're so attached to eating, they even lose their life also. Okay, man is more intelligent. Man may be more intelligent in defending himself than animals also. Correct, no? But is there any other thing that makes man more different than animals? Or you say that... they can't understand about the Atma. Okay, but humans can understand, comprehend. Like in a Kumbh Mela, how many crores of humans come, do you know? Sometimes 2-3 crore people come to Kumbh Mela. How many crores of dogs or cats come there? Nobody comes there. No animals come there. But why humans come? Because they know that in Kumbh Mela, if you take a dip in that, like in Ujjain, you have no holy dip. If you take, at that time, Amrita has fallen in that particular spot. If you take a dip, then you get moksha, you get immortality. So all the human beings come. They can have spiritual quest and spiritual aspirations. People are ready to come. You can see how many. So that means anywhere, even in a slum, you will find a gopuram of some small temple. You observed that? Wherever the human beings go. They have a very natural propensity to turn to God. And even those who don't turn to God, human beings have some sense of morality. You will see that. Some ethics. For example, a dog or a pig, they sometimes mate with mother, sister and daughter also. They don't know any difference. at all. Whereas in humans, you will find mother, sister, and daughter are seen as respectable personalities. And one, other than one's wife, one should consider every other woman like a mother. Correct, no? You will see that. So in the human body, that sense is there. Ethics is also there. What we should do, what we should not do. Human beings think about such things. Whereas in animals, you don't. Animals have no sense of such things. And most importantly, as it is said here, yeah, like you can see here, like America and other places, they have reached the summit of middle advancement, you see. Yeah, is human being only a two-legged, sophisticated, deluxe edition of animals? Or is he superior in any way? So we are going to see how is he superior. So you will find in the first world countries like America, there is so much of dissatisfaction and stress and people committing suicide. In New York itself, they say there are hundreds of gangsters. Shooting and criminalism is on the increase. Like I told you a few classes ago, in America they have 20 crore population, but 1.5 lakh jails. In India we have 120 crore population, but we only have 50,000 jails. So I asked all of you, how many jails are required in India if India becomes like America? So it was actually 9 lakh jails are required in India. Because America has 1.5 lakh for 20 crore. India has 120 crore. So multiply 1.5 by 6, 9 lakh. So instead of 9 lakh jails, we only have 50,000 jails. 50,000 jails mein kaam ho jata hai Bharat mein. How? Because people are dharmic, people are pious. People don't act like animals, ruthlessly. But these things what I have said are mainly happening in West. But when the Western people came to India, along with their MNCs, they brought their culture like a shadow. Do you agree? It has come into India very much. So because of that, that stress and anxiety is coming here also. We are finding that. See the difference between animal and human. Please repeat this verse. Ahara nidra bhayamaitunam cha. Samanyametat pashubirnaranam. Dharmohitesham adiko visheshu. Dharme nahina pashubhissamanam. Somebody read the translation, please. Okay.
The activities of eating, sleeping, mating. The activities of eating, sleeping, mating, and defending are common in animals. And human beings, common in animals and human beings. Yes. The human beings are considered superior only when they inquire about God and perform the dharma of obeying His laws. Loving, serving Him, otherwise they are considered just like animal.
Okay. That is dharma. Actually, we will come to that very soon. What is the dharma? It will be more clear. See, animals and human differences I have given here. See? They can only inquire about these four things. Where is my food? Like in the early morning, the bird gets up in the tree. Chun, 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 makes sense. What is the meaning of that? Where is my food? Where is my food? Where is my food? That's all they ask. Isn't it? And after the food is brought, then they eat. After eating, then go to sleep. And after sleeping, you get some strength. Then what to do? Sex life. And produce children. And after you produce your children, you have your family, then other animals have their family. Then there's a fight. Then defend. That's all they do. And after doing this, they have no other business. Like you see a cow or a bull or anybody, you will find that they just eat and just sit in one place. Correct, no? Dog also, just find your food, eat, and that's why they don't do anything else. But what the human being can inquire, he can inquire, what is life? What is death? What is beyond? What is this world? Who created this world? Why am I suffering? Is there any goal of life? They can ask these questions. Like, is there any of you here, would you play cricket if there is no stump, if there is no scoreboard at all? Would you want to play cricket? Or would you play a football match where there is no goalpost? On either side. Everything has a goal, correct? Here is a fan. What is the goal of the fan? To give air. Correct now. What is the goal of light? To give light. What is the goal of your car? To take you, transport you from one place to another. Is there anything in this world which has no goal or purpose? Similarly, how can your life not have a purpose? Correct now. Is your life, if you say that my life is to eat, sleep, mate and defend and die. That's what most people are thinking. Then they are no better than two-legged animals. So there are four-legged animals we have seen. So we also have two-legged animals called Dvipada Pashu. If they don't know any other goal, you understand? Therefore, we can inquire about what is the goal. I'll tell you a story which will help you understand it even more better. Once upon a time, a sadhu came to a king to teach him some Bhagavad Gita. But the king was in no mood at all. He was simply eating, sleeping, waiting, defending. That type of king. But he was polite to sadhus. When sadhu came, he said, Sadhu Mahatma, please take a donation and push off. I am too busy, you are selling. Sadhu understood he is in no mood to listen. But sadhu told him, my dear king, I have only one request of you. He said, in your kingdom, find out a fool and appoint him as the fool of your country and give a stick in his hand and ask him to roam about all over your country and give him a monthly some paycheck at the end of the month. If you do this, I'll be very satisfied, he said. And the king, because he was obedient to sadhu, at the same time he was stupid in his own sense gratification. He had no goal of life. So he told, okay, this is not a difficult thing for me. I'll employ one and I'll give him salary. So sadhu went away. Then he called the ministers and sent them out to find out a fool. Somehow they captured one fellow and brought, who was laughing to himself. He appeared like a fool. Then the king appointed him, gave him a stick to go about. And the fellow was going about. And many years later, the king suddenly got some disease. So he was in his deathbed. So he called all his relatives, queens, and ministers. He was talking to them. Then he also remembered that fool, Murka. So he told, hey, call that Murka also. So Murka also came. So then the king said, hey, my dear Murka, I am going to a very faraway place. Therefore, now I am taking a send-off from everybody. So I have called you also. And Murka said, oh, really? You are going to a faraway place? Can I also come with you? He asked. And the king said, No, you cannot accompany me, he said. Then Murka said, I think you are going to take your queens with you and you don't want to take me with you, right? He said. And the king said, oh, Murka, what can I tell you? Therefore, you are a Murka. None of my queens are going to come with me, he said. Then the Murka said, anyway, my dear king, maybe that's a private thing. I will not ask you. At least I will tell your ministers to arrange a chariot for you. And you can carry traveling food also. King did like this and said, "Arey, I can't carry a chariot. I can't carry any food. Really? If you don't have food, at least carry some gold coins with you so that you can purchase some things." King said, "I can't take any gold coins also with me. I can't take anything with me. I have to go with an empty hand," he said. Then the Murka said, "Really? What are you talking? You can't take all these things. You are a king. How can you go alone without all these things?" And then the king said, Enough. Don't hurt me anymore with all your questions. Keep your questions with yourself. I called you only for one purpose, he said. You have served me as a Murka for many years. Now you can take retirement and I will give you pension. And relax, don't worry. Just find another Murka who is better than Murka than you, Mahamurka. You are a Murka, get a Mahamurka and give your stick to him. And then he can go around the city and now you are getting old, you can relax, he said. And the Murka agreed, okay, my dear king, I'll find out and give, he said. He said, okay, do that, he said. And he gave the stick to the king only. The king was shocked. What are you saying? You're calling me a Mahamurka? The Murka said, yes, he said. How dare you say that, he said. Yes, my dear king, and I have my reason to substantiate what I am doing. He said, why I am calling you a Mahamurka? Did you not know that when you are going to die, your queens will not come with you. Your kingdom will not come with you. Your ministers won't come with you. You can't carry gold coins with you. You can't carry this chariot and elephants and horses and all your praja with you. And you have to go all alone. You know. So therefore it is said, na kuch saath laaye the, na kuch leke chalenge. Jo is duniya mein paya, idhar hi chod kar chalenge. Malum nahi tha aapko? Like that he asked him. And the king said, yeah, yeah, what you are saying is true. Malum tha, phir bhi kya kare? Bhul gaya. Therefore he said, you are Mahamurk. Like that he said. King heard him and said, oh, you are not an ordinary murk. I thought you are a fool. You are speaking great philosophy of Bhagavad Gita. Immediately, the king fell at the feet of Murk and said, honestly, tell me who you are. You are speaking such wonderful philosophy. Narendra Murka said, I am the disciple of the sadhu who came many years ago. You were not interested to listen to him. Therefore, he kept me in this kingdom. And I was appearing like a murk going around, but I was preaching also to people. Now I have come here to you, and my guru has posted me here to preach to you. Now it's high time for you. Your death will strike you down any time. Therefore, my dear king, do not waste your time anymore. Immediately take to Krishna consciousness. There is a copy of Bhagavad Gita. Study it immediately. So he started giving him classes. The king became an enlightened person before he left the body. So in this way, people may be highly educated. And they may be working in Microsoft. And they may be traveling all over the world, flying in planes. They may have a huge bank balance. They may be drawing 15 lakh, 20 lakh per annum, per month. People draw very easily nowadays. Like that. And they may be very proud of the degrees. They may be from IIT or MIT. But at the time of death, none of these things will come to our help. Because all these things will be left behind. You heard the story of this boatman and scientist. You all heard this? You know, one boatman was a village folk. He was driving the boat. He was driving the boat. And he used to sing. Hare Krishna used to be singing himself. All that he knew was chanting Hare Krishna and singing. So a scientist was sitting in the boat, and the scientist asked him, you know, do you know how to operate a computer? He asked him. Boatman said, I have never seen a computer in my life. The scientist said, your 25% of your life is a waste, he said. And then the scientist asked him after some time, you know, have you seen any Hollywood, Bollywood movies? He said, Ali Bali, what is this? I don't know anything. He said, oh, you are another 50% of your life is wasted. You really don't know how to enjoy life. You are a fool. You're wasted, he said. So, and then he said, do you know the latest type of, what is the latest type of computer, like a matchbox computer, what do you call it? The very smallest, smaller than palm top also one has come. So something like that he asked, do you know this? So he said, I already told you, I don't know anything. 70% of your life is wasted, he said. Suddenly when they were talking like this, the cyclone started coming in that ocean. So then the village folk, that fellow asked the scientist, sir, today it seems to be a very strange cyclone. Do you know swimming? Yeah, sir. Scientist said, sorry, I don't know swimming, he said. Your 100% life is wasted, he said. And then he, of course, the boat was toppled. This fellow could swim and come to the bank, and the other fellow was drowning. So why this story is said, the moral of the story is what? Whatever we all may study in our life, whatever knowledge you may acquire, whatever money you may acquire, the ultimate goal of life you should not forget. If you have forgotten that, our life is a waste. That you can inquire in which body? See, in human body, you can do these three things. You can ask, why am I suffering? And what is the goal of life? How to harmonize our life with God and nature? This is another important question. Why am I suffering? See, when I was a school boy, once I took, you know this stick we use for cleaning the top ceiling and all? What do you, there is a bushy broom. You know that? We have a long stick like this. So one day I was doing that. And one kitten came in. Very cute looking, small kitten. So I wanted to play with the kitten. So I showed it on his face like this, And the kitten was surprised, what is this? He just couldn't understand it. Then he was biting it and, you know, trying to bite and remove it. Then I pushed the kitten, then it fell off, you know. Then it would get up and again try to, again, fight with it, wrestle with it. So I was watching that. Poor kitten didn't know, behind that bushy broom there is a long stick, and the long stick is in the hands of Radhesham Das. He doesn't know that. All that he is seeing is what? Only the bushy broom. That's all he is seeing. So in this world also, you will see that suffering can never be automatic. Suffering is given by somebody. If I call one of you, come here, our dear friend, you can come here. So now you close your eyes, you can turn there. You close your eyes now. So I am giving him a pinch now. You are feeling the pain?
Yes.
Okay. Now you don't know who is pinching, but you feel the pain, correct, no? Okay, you can say no. So now he is feeling the pain, but he doesn't know who is inflicting the pain. But he knows that somebody is inflicting the pain, correct, no? So you will see, in this world there are three types of sufferings. Sufferings are arising from your body and mind. Like body, what sufferings arise in your body?
Disease,
old age, death, these are all bodily pains. And what sufferings you get in your mind?
Stress,
worry, fear, anxiety, greed. These are all pinching the mind. Correct, no? You all understand what I'm saying? So this is one type of suffering your own body and mind is giving. Then there are other sufferings coming from other people. Correct, no? Like one of our boys got married and settled in Bombay, Mira Road, you know. So his friend came to see him. He said, "Hey, you got an independent bungalow now. You have a beautiful garden. And you have a Sintex tank at the top. You get 24 hours water supply. Yeah? And you are newly married now. You have your own car. So everything seems to be in place. You must be a happy man, isn't it?" He said, "Yes, I am happy. But," he said, "what is that but?" He said, "these mosquitoes in this area, they're too much. Yeah? They don't let you sleep at all," he said. Similarly, you ask a lady, "Oh, you are married now in Chetla, are you happy?" "Oh, everybody is nice, everything is nice, but my mother-in-law," they will say. So every fellow in this world has a but. You have seen that? Because somebody in this world will give you trouble. You agree? How many of you sitting here, you feel that you get some trouble from somebody at least? You agree? Yeah. Not necessarily human beings. It could be dengue, you know, mosquito also. Correct, no? It could be anything. That means the second suffering is suffering coming from other living beings. Third suffering is suffering coming from the devatas through the natural calamities. Like, example? Kerala flood now, you heard about it? Very recent one, correct, no? Where Palakkad and all, below, yeah. How many houses are all thrashed down and all? How many? More than a lakh, yeah. Man has no power, although man claims to be very powerful. He's advanced in science and technology, but he can't do anything in these situations. You know the tsunami? Correct, no? 3.8 lakh people are finished off. So these are all natural calamities, which is the wrath of nature, which is coming. In America, there was New Orleans. You heard about that? A few years ago. They say Katrina, Rita. Names are only beautiful. But they slap you and whip you and rip you. Isn't it? But our Shastras say, these three miseries I told you, miseries from body and mind, other living beings, and nature. These three are the Trishul of Durga. You all have seen Durga having a Trishul. This is what is the meaning of Durga's Trishul. Durga is sitting on a tiger back. And she's carrying Trishul and she's piercing one fellow below. You seen that? Like that, she's piercing all of us in this world. This is material world. We'll come to that point. Now you may have a question, why is she giving us this three type of troubles? We will come to understand it. Very soon we'll come. But you agree there are sufferings in this world? These three type of sufferings? You all agree? Now, when you get suffering, you want a solution. Correct? You want to come out of suffering. Is there anybody here you want to suffer here? Or you want to come out of suffering? Yeah. But when you want to come out of suffering, see, you go to a doctor. Ask me water bottle. See, you go to a doctor. Nowadays, if you go to a doctor, you say, "Oh, doctor, my stomach is paining." You say, "Brufen, take it." "Oh, doctor, my knee is paining." Again, "Brufen." "Doctor, my neck is paining." "Brufen." You say, "Sir, Brufen 200 you gave, it's not working." "Okay, Brufen 500. "Okay, sir, that is also not working nowadays." "Brufen 800. Brufen 2000. Brufen 3000. "Doctor, Brufen 3000 also is not working." Then you die. That's all. So you will find, you will be surprised, many doctors prescribe painkillers for all types of pains, whether neck pain, stomach pain, or you know, knee pain. But you go to a Ayurvedic doctor, if you say you have stomach pain, first thing he will ask you, what did you eat yesterday night? Then you think and say, oh, yesterday night I went to a party and they gave us a pizza. Huh? Big pizza I ate at 12 o'clock at night. Then he will tell you, your pizza is sitting in your belly. Take this powder and flush it out. And then when it's flushed out, stomach is empty, no pain. That means Ayurvedic doctors go to the root cause. And many times in allopathy, people just see the pain and give you a painkiller. Correct, no? So, similarly, when you are suffering, intelligence means to go to the root cause of suffering. So right now we are all sitting in a program. Imagine there is some nasty smell coming from inside of a dead rat or something. So I may tell all of you, please can you get a Odonil or something? It's so badly smelling. You put a Odonil during the class. Somehow during the class you survived. But when Odonil gets over, then what happens? Huh? Again the dead rat smell will come. Isn't it? So any solution you all can give? One boy told, sir, we should get a bigger Odonil, he said. Small one, you know, it gets consumed. So maybe we can get few more pieces of Odonil. Is it a good solution?
No.
That will take some more time. You have to go inside and remove the bureaus, chairs, everything, find out the rat. And once somebody brings the rat and shows, hey, this is the fellow giving the smell, and throw it so far away, along with it will be gone the smell also. Correct, no? Go to the root cause of the smell. Correct, no? Like at one time in IITs, the suicides had increased. So they became very worried. So there was a board meeting of all the managers and professors and all. So they asked, why are the boys committing suicide and how are they committing? So some professors said, sir, the problem is most of the suicides have been done by hanging in the fan. Then they said, we remove the fans and put AC so that they cannot commit suicide. Is it a good solution?
No.
Why it's not a good solution, tell me. Yeah, they will find another way to die, isn't it? So are they going to root cause or are they superficially solving?
Superficially solving.
Yes, that means there are two types of solutions. One is going to root cause of the problem. Another one is superficially solving problem. So now in the coming slides, you will understand those things. It will become more clear to you. The last one is to attain eternal happiness. We all are looking for happiness. Correct, no? See, you have a choice in your life. You inquire about those four things which you said. That means, what is the goal of life? What is the cause of suffering? To attain eternal happiness, correct, no? Then you make such inquiry, you are promoted to higher life. Like you all have been coming to these classes last 3-4 times. And you are getting promoted to better and better understanding of what is life, what is the meaning of life, correct, no? On the other hand, you have another. When we don't have any inquiry, then we are acting instinctively. Acting by instinct means act like an animal. Nowadays, many boys, girls, they act like two-legged animals only. They have no culture. They have no meaning of life, goal of life. They eat anywhere. They sleep anywhere. They mix with anybody. One of my students was studying in IIM. He was studying in IIM Indore only was studying. So he once sent a mail to me saying that in our college, they had given us some project to do somewhere in some area. So the four students went, but these four, out of these four students, he was also one of them. The other three of them had brought their girlfriends. They were staying in a hall like this, and there are four cots, and in the three cots, both are lying with their friends, girlfriends. And this fellow was single in the cot. So while he was lying single in the cot, he made a phone call to me and said, Prabhu, in the same hall, three boys are giggling, laughing, joking inside a blanket with their girlfriends. And I am here alone. Please give me strength by which I can preserve my purity. He said, nowadays people go to anything beyond limits of mixing with boys, girls, and they also complicate their lives. This is the age in which you are living in. That means you have to be a man of such high character that even if one has opportunities to exploit and enjoy, one shouldn't exploit. Correct, no? Otherwise, we live like animals. Animals have no one. Any dog says, this is my wife, you know, I am the husband, she's my wife. Any dog says that, they will go to anybody. Correct, no? They go to any dog. And dogs also tear each other's body. You have seen that? Huh? Sometimes you find in the night there is one she-dog and there are a dozen male dogs, bah, 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 all of them, because they can't control their senses. They go behind a she-dog. And then when a big bulldog comes, all of them get lost. And then carries her and goes away. And similar things can happen in human life also. Do you agree? If human beings are not controlled. Do you agree or not? It can happen or it can't happen? Can happen very easily. And for sake of one female, people are shooting each other. You can see that. Therefore, if we don't, you will find our eating, sleeping, mating, defending can be peaceful if you have dharma. For example, if you all follow dharma, say a boy marries a girl and he puts a kumkum. As soon as the kumkum comes here, then all the other men understand, oh, she's a married woman. We should not unnecessarily get close to her. She is married, she has a husband, they have children. Don't disturb. But if we have no dharma, then anybody can become attracted to any woman and elope with her. Do you agree? Correct, no? This is about mating. Same with eating also. If you have dharma, we have time for God, we have time for office, we have time for family, you have time for yoga, everything. But if you have no dharma, you know, then you will find that you want to make such a huge money that people work 16 hours a day. They stand in some fast food center and they gulp down food. and they have to run to office. So their eating program is spoiled, correct, no? Are they able to sleep well? For sleeping, what they have to take? Sleeping pills. So eating program, sleeping program, mating program, defending program, all are spoiled without dharma. That means without dharma, even materially you cannot be happy. Do you understand? So therefore, with your wide open eyes, dear friends, all of you look at the world around you. People around you are struggling like anything nowadays, impelled by stress. That's because the farther you go from dharma, the greater your sufferings will be. That means more and more materialistic you become, then the fever, it's like increasing fever. The more and more spiritual minded you become, it's like coming to 98.6 degree Fahrenheit. So you want to become healthy and have the ideal temperature, or you want to become high 103, 104 degree Fahrenheit. That is feverish. So without dharma, one lives like an animal. Two questions I told you, correct? Why am I suffering? What is the goal of life? See what this fellow is trying to do, can you say?
Get out.
Yeah, he's trying to get out, but he's unable, he doesn't know where the door is. Similarly, we all also in this world, like right now, say we are sweating, we are not comfortable. Similarly, in winter season, we are too cold. It's too cold. We don't like too much heat, we don't like too much cold, we don't like to be insulted by anybody, we don't like scarcity, we don't like. So you will find that the Trivida Tap, I told you, Adhyatmika, Ati Bhautika, Ati Daivika. Adhyatmika means body and mind sufferings. Adi Bhautika means other living beings. And Adi Daivika means by the Devatas through the nature, which are Trishul of the Durga. So we don't like these three. But although you don't like these three, can you avoid them? You can't avoid them. We are living in the middle of them. Like this fellow is trying to come out, he's battering, he doesn't know how to. We are all struggling also in the same manner in this world. Why am I suffering? See, here is a quiz for you. Your problem can be considered a real problem if it fulfills the three criteria. It's common to all, nobody wants it, nobody can avoid it. Tell me, any problem? Which is, death is a common to all, nobody wants to die, and nobody can avoid it. Yes, old age also is like that, yes. Yes?
Disease
also is like that, is it not? Yeah, repeated birth and death. So, yeah, what is this? This is old age. These are actresses. You can see this. See, right now you will see.
Most people spend their lives wrapped up in rushing to and fro,
People are running
always.
As time
flows quickly by, days, months, and years rush by in the blink of an eye. Yet for some reason, people try to ignore this fact.
You see how a person ages from childhood?
They think they will never grow old. Yet the days of youth that they so fondly imagine will never end are really very short. Almost everyone realizes that he will grow old one day. Yet young people always feel that those days are very far off. They refuse to accept that they will one day be old, weak, and helpless. The two young people in this picture are good-looking, with clean and perfect skins and shining teeth. But there is another important detail. These pictures were taken in 1955. When this picture was taken, these two were most probably not giving any thought to the fact that they would one day grow old. Yet some 50 years or more have now gone by, and nothing remains of the youth and beauty in the picture.
My Lord, what a change, eh?
Time destroys everything. That is a law of the world.
See, the cosmetic industries are booming. Why? Because people want to remain
young.
Insurance industry is booming. Why? Because people want to. People know that, you know, because of fear of death, they want to save. See, there was one Texas oil millionaire. When he became 72 years old, he suddenly realized that I am getting old and getting wrinkles. So he spent millions of dollars to pay to scientists to research on what is old age. In Indian Express, there was a big article on the mechanism of old age. So the scientists found out that the number of dying cells are more than the number of cells getting replenished. They found out that. And they exactly found out how the aging takes place. And then they told him. So he said, okay, now that you know the mechanism, can you help me out? So that at least beyond 72, I don't age because I have a lot of work to do, he was telling. They said, sorry, sir. They said, as much as we have no control over the sun or moon, like that we have no control over the old age. And it came in the paper, a big article came in the paper. So no matter how much science advances, you will not be able to stop old age. Maybe you can wear facelift. You know facelift? You can remove the wrinkles and look like a young person for some time. But actually internally, the body has grown old, isn't it? I heard a funny story. Once a man who was attracted to a pretty-looking young girl, he estimated her age to be 16 or something. So he walked behind. She had long hair, flowing hair. She had a cooling glass. She had a stylish cap. When she was walking, he walked behind her. And then she entered a house, and he wanted to get more information about her so that he can follow her up. So when he peeped through the window, as soon as he saw her, she removed the cap and removed the wig. And it was like this. And he was shocked. Then she removed her facelift. Then again she got the wrinkles. She removed her teeth set. And then she became immediately. And she removed her goggles. And eyes were deep inside the socket. And then she removed her high heels. She became half the height practically. Then he understood that was not a girl. It was a 60-year-old woman who had made her external appearance like a young girl. In modern times, you have so many facilities to make you look young. Agreed? Correct? Now there is wig, there are special tooth set. So many things people do So these are all called as stop gap temporary solution. What solution? Yeah. Yeah. Therefore, people capture sweet memories, correct, no? Otherwise, after getting old, people keep these photos and everything, and they keep watching it. You can only say, how beautiful I looked. He's showing this old man, see? Yeah. We, everybody want to be healthy like this. Yeah. But eventually, diseases come. Nobody likes. Fifth month, hunger and thirst. This is about the child in the womb. Mother eats bitter, salty and all, child suffers. This is talking about the birth of the child in the womb. Amniotic fluid. Birth is also not a very comfortable thing. It's like you are put in a dungeon, in a go-down kind of thing. Child is just thinking, oh my Lord, I want to come out. All around there is amnion, stool, urine, everything. And the child is upside down. So the four things are mentioned. Birth, disease, Krishna says this. Janma, mrityu, jara, vyadi, dukkha, dosha, anudarshanam. I can show you that verse. Yeah, see this one. This is in Bhagavad Gita, 13.8-12. Janma, mrityu, jara, vyadi, dukkha, dosha, anudarshanam. You saw this? This one. Krishna says this. Intelligent person in this world, human being means janma, mrityu, jara. Jara means? Old age. Vyadi means?
Disease.
Dukkha, dosha, anudarshanam. How they give us suffering, one should understand. Then you are intelligent person. Krishna says. See, Anuvad, if you see the translation, we'll say here. Intelligent person is one. Perception of evil of birth, death, old age and
disease.
That's one of the items of knowledge. So this is a real problem of life. People think, you know, we don't have 24 hours water supply in our colony. That's a problem. Or people say, oh, the train is very crowded. Those are all secondary problems. The real problem is these four. Yeah, I got it then. These three classes I told you, remember? Adhyatmika means body and mind. Correct? See, children are suffering from academic pressure, lack of family support, stress. These are all adhyatmika klesh. Adhyatmika. And then, adhibhautika. Adhibhautika can be from other, you see, those are terrorist fellows. They are also adhibhautika klesh. Terrorist snake. Or somebody, or the mosquitoes, somebody insulting you. Somebody, what is this one? Like extreme left. What is that?
Pickpocket.
Pickpocket. They are also adibhautika klesh. Adidaivika klesh. You understand? I can show you one real life experience. You can see. Adidaivika klesh. Japan.
Large chunks of buildings fell to the streets as people rushed for cover.
The skyscrapers nearby were swaying.
Oh, building rain collapsed.
I did think at one point that I really might die here.
And then round two as the tsunami sirens wail.
You're seeing live footage of a tsunami engulfing the port area. When the ominous Black Sea attacked this island nation Friday, it left behind a massive trail of destruction that is getting worse by the hour.
A giant tsunami wave crashes into the Fukushima Daiichi power plant, seriously damaging the building's reactors.
The Japanese Prime Minister Naoto Kan said today the disaster is the worst crisis for Japan since World War II.
Southern USA, okay.
The National Weather Service in Birmingham, what is it? Alabama has issued a tornado warning for Tuscaloosa County. A tornado warning means that tornado has been spotted heading for your area. Seek shelter in an interior.
This has been the country's worst and deadliest tornado outbreak since the Great Depression.
Governor Deal declared a state of emergency in 16 counties.
You think the death toll will go up?
Yes, sir.
Monster tornado.
The tornado moves slowly, 6 miles through the center of Joplin. The town is now effectively...
Jesus.
Search and rescue crews sift through the rubble.
Areas of the city.
Proceed. Keep fighting.
City of Christchurch.
From this city of several...
Lasting impression on the landscape and on the...
Wouldn't happen
the way this thing is working.
Memories and clothes.
Of Europe.
It is staying on course to head north with major American cities still...
Sections of Manhattan.
What we also saw was a lot of flooding.
Massive dust storm rolled through Phoenix. It was more than a mile and a half high. Take a look at this.
It came roaring into town at 60 miles per hour.
One man dead, more than a dozen injured in multiple pileups involving
scene of war.
It registered 7.2 on the scale.
See those that are still caught beneath the rubble.
Pulled alive from a collapsed building.
There's no doubt in my mind.
Flow as many people are waiting for word on their loved ones, and comfort is all they can give each other.
Talk to one another, help each other out, do the very best you can. We will come through this.
We're going to keep helping these people. This is what we enlisted for.
The things that people need right now, we're preparing. Water, blankets, medical support.
Okay. A few I showed you. You know, you might have seen also. So... I told you, Katrina, Rita, and all that, they're all representatives of Durga, Mata. Actually, great world wars are enacted by Durga also. When Durga Mata sees that human beings are killing millions of cows in gelatin machines, or millions of boys, girls are uniting and producing babies and aborting the children. These two are considered very gruesome murders. People aborting the children and killing innocent animals, like cows, goats, chicken, and all of them. Then Durga sees that, so many people are there to whom I have to punish. And it will take long time for her to punish. So what she does, she creates a war between two countries. Just like sometimes a classroom teacher, what she does, she calls two students. You catch his ears and you catch his ears. Both of you sit down, stand up, sit down. Like that she does, no? Like that Durga creates war between two countries. Russia and America, for example. And then two countries fight and millions of soldiers are killed. And who are the soldiers? Who are getting killed? Who are they? They are the ones who killed the cows, who aborted the children. Because they killed somebody, they have to be killed also back. And Durga is laughing, ha 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 ha, in such wars. Because she enacts these things, karmic reaction, she is the one who is giving through the Trivida Tap. You understand now why she is giving suffering? Is it clear to all of you? Yeah. Although we are advanced in medical science, some boys may argue that, you know, sir, we are not less advanced. We have such facility, latest technology, state-of-art technology we have. But still you will see our plants are thwarted by new diseases. Like you see this dengue. What else, you know, new disease, latest, famous ones, recent. Swine flu in Pune, 10 lakh people are wearing masks in their mouth. Any train passed through Pune, I saw them wearing masks, people. And the mask sellers had good business. So, swine flu is such a virus, you can't even see with eyes. And if it goes into your system, you are finished. You see this fellow, who is it? He used to say, I am the greatest. He knocked so many people down. But now, he died of actually Parkinson's disease. He couldn't even lift a coffee. See, his hands are shaking. You saw this? He's not able to hold. He lost. So why great people suffer from problems? How can they be solved? See, these are the solutions given by modern day advancement. These are things, correct? You see them in TV also, tranquilizers, painkillers. In fact, these things leave side effects also. If you eat little more painkillers, little more sleeping pills, people die also. You know that? Overdose of sleeping pills. It can lead to death. And the painkillers, do they cure the disease? What do? They suppress the disease and make you feel everything is all right with you. Correct, no? See, a scientist is saying that a man can fly like a bird in the sky now because you have aeroplanes. And he said we can swim like a fish underwater. Only problem is you can't walk like a human being on the road because there is air pollution. There is water pollution, noise pollution. Yeah. Actually, in Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, Kshayaya Jagatu Ahitaha. Like in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, they dropped a bomb and killed many people. Therefore, Lord Krishna says, by wars, man becomes inimical to one another and they kill each other. Imagine a student in India doing a doctorate degree. And then the Indian government may tell him, now you produce a special type of bomb which you can drop in Pakistan. And Pakistan picks another big scientist, doctorate. They will say, you make another bomb which you can drop in India. That means even after becoming a doctorate, that bomb dropping buddhi doesn't go away. Correct? No? Like the dog or like animalistic buddhi. So what is the use of that education which makes people barbaric like this? Therefore, spiritual education is needed. Do you agree? See, you go and tell a scientist, sir, I have old age, what to do? You know, I have white hair now. Don't worry, you use a hair dye. You see, sir, I have wrinkles. Okay, use facelift. Sir, I have back pain. Use painkillers. So use oxygen. So these are called, I told you, superficial patch-up solutions. Because they patch up externally, but internally you have grown old. Internally the disease is spreading in the body. And that's the point. See, patching up is useless. We want real solution. See, once a boy was getting pimples on his face, all over. He was looking very ugly. All friends told him, hey, what is happening to you? So he felt very bad, went to a doctor, and doctor gave an ointment, just like we have Clearasil and others. So he applied it. And appeared, the pimples went away. He was very happy. After a week, again they appeared. Again he went to the doctor and said, doctor said, I already gave you a paste ointment. Just keep applying it. So he would apply it, go away. After a week, it will come back again. So one paste got over. Doctor said, buy some more and keep with you. Whenever it comes, keep applying. Then he went to the doctor and said, doctor, dozen ointment paste have got over. This keeps coming. What to do? Doctor said, see, I don't know any other medicine. This is the only thing I know. You keep applying it, as long as it keeps coming, keep applying it. Is it a good doctor? Then he went to another doctor. He said, you are getting it repeatedly because there is some impurity in your blood. So he gave an injection to remove the toxin in the blood. Then no more pimples after that. That's called permanent solution. You understand, no? So which solution do you want? You want a stopgap solution or a permanent solution? We'll come to that. These are all patch-up solutions. So although we have become very advanced in science and technology, we cannot eradicate disease per se from the planet. Can any scientist confidently touch his heart and say, now that we have so much advanced, no more disease in this planet? They are very proud nowadays, saying that, smallpox, chickenpox and all, people used to suffer. Now we have medicine. Earlier we didn't have medicine. Earlier they used to have only this neem leaves and all that people used to put. Now, so scientists are very proud. Okay, you have eradicated one disease, but new diseases have come now, isn't it? There was an article in a newspaper which said resurgence of diseases, it says. 10 years ago, whatever diseases disappeared, now they are coming back with much more vigor and vitality, power in destroying the bodies. Like I used to take chloroquine for this malaria. When I got once or twice malaria, chloroquine. Now when I told the doctor, doctor, one devotee is having malaria, should we give him chloroquine? He laughed and said, what chloroquine? That's a old medicine, he said. Now we have malaria medicines which are, you know, 20 times, 25 times more powerful than chloroquine, he said. I asked, really? He said, yes, mosquitoes have become too strong now, he's saying, than before. They were never so mighty. Because we came up with medicines, mosquitoes understood these fellows are using medicines. So they became more mighty to attack more powerfully. Now we have even more powerful medicines. But the problem is they leave a lot of side effects. So in this way you will find advancement is there, but that is not able to remove the diseases completely from the planet. Yeah. See, luxury and comforts cannot satisfy the soul. This is, see this picture. Somebody is giving hamburger to a fish. So, and the fish is shivering out of water. So, what does it mean? Can you guess what it is? See, these people are giving a TV, some film fair magazine, hamburger, currency notes, but the fish is, you know, gasping for life air, like this. What do you understand from this picture? Anybody can? Yeah? Yeah, so what should you do with the fish? Live in the water. So one part of the example you have understood. Now let me ask other students. You can say, partly he has answered it. So what is it analogous to? You know analogy? Actually I want them to answer. You answer part of it, other part. I want to check whether they understood that. Fish part, what he said is correct. If you apply the same to human, how does it apply to human? Actually, for soul to be in spiritual world is natural, which is like a fish being in the ocean. But when the fish is taken out of the ocean, just as you provide so many things, still it's not. He's holding a cigarette. Isn't it? Still not happy. Similarly, you tell me, modern man, what does he not have? Tell me. It's everything. You know, there are so many kinds of video games people play. There are so many kinds of eatables. Man has used his brain to start star hotels. There is a star hotel which is a rotating hotel, they said. I asked, what is rotating hotel? The whole room rotates. It's a very tall tower. You know, the top room, they have made a rotating room. They said, while eating, you can look all around. You know? But same thing only you eat. Whether you rotate and eat or sit and eat, what difference it makes? But they made like that. Nowadays, there is a space age bed. You heard about it? Space age bed is a Dunlop pillow bed. And when you lie down in the morning, whatever time you want to get up, the bed will start doing like this. And it will do like this. Slowly it will wake you up. And in summer season, it will put cold water inside. So you'll feel very nice. In winter season, they put hot water. Very nice. So the bed has many, many switches. You can press and do many, many things in there. So we call it space age bed. So man, why I'm telling you this, there is no limit to luxury. That man is doing. But is he happy with all that? So therefore, a fish example is given. So this is the difference between devas and asuras. Devatas means, if you have Devi Sampath, you will believe in God. These people have no faith in God. He follows the laws of God, like Yudhishthir Maharaj. This side you find, his philosophy is eat, drink and be merry. He understands his world is temporary. Body will be finished. Old age, disease, death will be finished. Whereas this fellow thinks, no, the life in this world is everything. He doesn't care about the future. He follows the regulative principles. Actually, in the Srimad Bhagavatam, four types of sins are explained, which Srila Prabhupada instituted even in America also when he went. Some people told Prabhupada, Swamiji, if you teach these four principles, many Americans will turn away. They will not take to it. But Prabhupada said, I have to repeat the scriptures. So he spoke the truth. You know what are the four? You heard about it? Dyutam, Panam, Striya, Suna, Yatra, Adharmas Chaturvida. It is said. Adharma means these are all non-dharmic. One should not do. What are they? Meat eating, gambling, intoxication, illicit sex. So we call it gimme. Gimme formula, I can remember. G for gambling, I for illicit sex, and M for meat eating, and I for intoxication. So gambling means big money or no money. It causes tension to your head. Correct, no? Similarly, illicit sex means sex before marriage or sex outside marriage. Sex within marriage is allowed, but not sex outside marriage or before marriage. That's illicit sex. Thirdly, yeah, for meat eating. Why we don't eat meat? I told in the Stress to Smile seminar, I told, meat involves killing of an animal. At that time, the animal tries to save his life, want to escape. It's called flight. And it cannot escape, it fights back. So there is a fight-flight mechanism which causes adrenaline secretion. It permeates the body of the animal. So whoever eats it, they also develop insecurity and fear in tamoguna, and they develop a fighting tendency, which is rajoguna. So if you want rajoguna, tamoguna, then you have to eat meat. But if you want to have some pure, pristine qualities, then sattoguna. Then we eat vegetarian food. So G-I-M. And fourth I is intoxication means like smoking, drinking, drugs. Absolutely one should give up all this. So devotees follow these principles. And these fellows are envious of others. They live an unregulated life and goes to hell. So that's the difference between the two. See, the foolish people know that they will, see, they exist and suddenly blip, like a bubble in an ocean. Everything is finished in a moment. But they are chasing after acquiring the pleasures of this world. So I've shown you what are the pleasures. See, they want to have boozing parties. They want to play games. Like one old man, Prabhupada saw him in America. Not only one old man, many old men were playing golf course. They were all playing golf. So you had to put a ball in a hole in the ground. Prabhupada was telling youngsters in America while walking, he said, just look at those old fellows. You know, a old dog cannot learn new tricks, he said. Because the old dog is already conditioned and his mind is almost set. He only knows the same thing only, same old thing. If you teach a new thing, he cannot catch. And purpose, look at those old guys. Their life is about to end. They're going to die in a few years. But what are they doing? He said, they are aiming at how to put this ball in the hole. They may become a rat in that hole. He said, because they have no other goal. That's the only goal they have. So these are people waste their human life, which is actually meant for self-realization. Read it. What is given there in the top?
We want to. We want to learn.
His mic is working.
We want to lord over material nature and want to control things without caring for God, who is the real proprietor and controller.
Yeah. Do you understand the meaning of the word lording over? Like Ravana wanted to catch any woman who was beautiful and bring her to Lanka for his enjoyment. So he wanted to lord over the women. And there was one Hiranyakashipu long before. Hiranya means gold. Kashipu means soft bed, which means he wanted to enjoy women and money. So he conquered all the places in the whole world. Upper, middle, lower, everything. And he sat in Indra's seat. And his eyes were always rolling like copper balls. He was always drunk in liquor. Sometimes devatas would bring some gift for him. To give him, sir, keep it here and get lost, he would tell them. And they would be trembling. So all the devatas, nobody could. In fact, he told the Varuna, Vayu, Agni and all of you, give a resignation letter and push off, he said. Sir, but how will we do our service? He said, no service required. I will take care of all these departments. Like that. Very mighty asura. He was so mighty that he could command the nature and say, hey, halka barish. Then he would get halka barish. Today, you see, if sun is very hot, modern day scientists, they put an AC room in a room. Correct, no? Whereas Hiranyakashipu could control the sun also. He was very, very mighty in his times. You read in Samantha Kanda Srimad Bhagavatam, you read about him. But he was the fellow who was killed by whom? Krishna, how Krishna killed them? In what form Krishna killed them? Narasimha, correct? To protect Prahlad he came. So modern day atheistic people are also small Hiranyakashipus. Why? You find that they are also trying to exploit nature. You have seen people exploiting nature? There is a big talk going on about environment nowadays, correct? Like for example, they are throwing the polluted gases into the air. They are throwing polluted effluents into the water without treating them. So when people are drinking those waters, they get diseases. Some animals die also because of that. So can you think of more examples, like I told you just now, how the man is exploiting other people and nature? Give some examples. Because I use the word lording over the material nature. Cutting down trees in big number, but for what purpose? Yeah, they are cutting the trees and they are making papers and publishing all pornography magazines. Cine Blitz, Debonair, all kinds of dirty magazines. By reading which people's minds are more polluted. And at least if they cut down trees and print Bhagavad Gita and give, people will read it and get purified and go back to God, and tree will get a human body also. Correct, no? Yeah, because if a tree is cut and the paper is made and Bhagavad Gita is printed, then the tree gets a human body because his body is used for God's service. And the people who read Bhagavad Gita, they go back to God. But as you rightly said, people are cutting down trees and making dirty magazines and polluting minds of masses. Any other example? That was a good example. Any other example? Do you all see bhoga vritti in the people of this world, or you see seva vritti in the people? You have to say, what are the examples of bhoga vritti you have to give? How do you say they are doing bhoga vritti? Polluting river. That answer I already released. You have to give a new one. You can't quote the same example. Like one biology teacher asked, can you give an example for amphibian? One boy said, frog. She asked another boy, you have any other example? She said, another frog. He said, so that's not allowed. You have to give a new example. You have to give.
IT companies polluting minds.
Yeah, internet pornography, polluting the minds of people. See, in America also Prabhupada saw people with fat bodies were going for morning walk so that they can make their body thin. And he saw there are beggars who don't have any food. Prabhupada said, this fellow is eating too much and that fellow has no food. So he should give that food to this fellow. Then both can be happy. Correct, no? So people have too much to, like Anil Ambani's family has 80 rooms in Bombay, if you see. They live very lavish lives. But there are poor people who don't get even 3 days any meal to eat also. So greedy and lavish lifestyle is also lording over. Like you keep a sack of rice outside, your sparrow will come, eat little and go away. Dog will come, eat little and go away. But a human being comes, what he will do? You'll take little and go away? You'll take the whole sack, he will take away. So Gandhi said, there is enough in this world for everyone's need, but not for one man's greed, he said. So greed is one lording over mentality. Man wants to, like Duryodhana wanted to usurp the land of Pandavas. Correct? Now, similarly, modern times also people want to exploit others. Nowadays, sometimes people, women put cases against people to make a lot of money. Correct? Now, that is also exploitation. Suing others. In America, it's very famous. Suing for no reason. Correct, no? Actually, it may be the karma of the poor people to be poor, but dharma entails that the rich people should do dana dharma, and they should give food, clothing, because God has given them more. If they see, the wealth they possess is not theirs, it belongs to God. If they give it, then they also get punya by that. And the poor will be taken care of. God actually can give the poor also. Instead of giving poor, God wants to give it through the others. He makes somebody rich and checks. Like a parent may tell a senior boy, there are two children parents have, one grown-up boy and small boy. They may give four toys to the grown-up boy and say, now let us see what he does. Whether he takes all of them or gives two of them to his younger brother. Correct, no? So God also gives like that. So this type of, see, exploitation, we can give innumerable examples. Now I'll speak in a certain way, you will immediately understand it. There is a word used, tena tyaktena bhunjita. You are allowed to have one wife. You know? But if a man is trying to enjoy another man's wife, that is going beyond his quota. Correct? Correct, no? Similarly, you can have your own land to live, but to usurp someone else's property by cheating them, that is considered encroachment. Correct, no? Encroaching others' property. In the same manner, we can see you are allowed to live a peaceful life, but not talk so much that the other children of God are suffering. That is not allowed. So in this way, we can give, if you watch, we can give many, many examples. Right now in our heart, there are three great enemies, which are called the lust, anger, and greed. So these three enemies are the root cause of all problems in this world. By chanting Hare Krishna, you can nullify these three completely. And one can rise above. Basically, these are like viruses in our system, you can say. Like a virus spoils a computer, like that. So here we have shown the picture of Vishnu. Why? God is a real proprietor and controller. In Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, he says that Sarva Loka Maheshwaram, all the worlds belong to me. I created them, he says. But people in this world, do they even talk a word about God? They take everything and they enjoy. Like for example, I'll show you one verse. We'll repeat that verse. We will repeat one verse. Yeah, please repeat this verse. Ishtan bhogan hi vo deva. Dasyante yajna bhavitaha. Tairdattan apradayaibhyo. Yobungte stena eva saha. See. The various necessities of life are supplied by the devatas. And one should do yajna. No? And these supply necessities are all supplied. But anyone who enjoys the gifts of nature without offering to the devatas, then he becomes a thief. Uses the word thief. In this purport, Prabhupada says, I'll show you. He says here, how people are exploiting. See this one. Okay, here, from here onward, he says. See, read this one. Any of you? Three categories Prabhupada is saying here, of things we are taking from God.
No one can manufacture anything. Yes. Take, for example, all the eatables of human society. These eatables include grain, fruits, vegetables, milk, sugar, etc. for the persons in the mode of goodness, and also eatables for the non-vegetarians like meats, none of which can be manufactured by men.
Correct. None of this can manufacture. The first category is saying all the eatables. Then second category is saying. Great.
Then again, take for example heat, light, water, air, etc., which are also necessities of life. None of them can be manufactured by the human society. Without the Supreme Lord, there can be no profuse sunlight, moonlight, rainfall, breeze, etc., without which no one can live. Obviously, our life is dependent on supplies from the Lord.
This is the second category. Now the third category here.
Even for our manufacturing enterprises, we require so many raw materials like metals, sulfur, mercury, manganese, and so many essential, all of which are supplied by the agents of the Lord, with the purpose that we should make proper use of them to keep ourselves fit and healthy for the purpose of self-realization, leading to the ultimate goal of life, namely liberation from the material struggle for existence. This aim of life is attained by performance of yajna. If we forget the purpose of human life and simply take supplies from the agents of the Lord for sense gratification and become more and more entangled in material existence, which is not the purpose of creation, certainly we become thieves, and therefore we are punished by the laws of material nature. A society of thieves can never be happy because they have no aim in life. The gross materialist thieves have no ultimate goal of life. They are simply directed to sense gratification.
Do you all understand it? So now a question for you. What are the three things you are taking from nature created by God? What are the first things said? First is grains, fruits, cereals, milk. That was the first category. Second category is air, sunlight, water, yes, all these things also, which are necessities of life, correct, no? We are breathing. At every moment, without oxygen, we cannot breathe. So God has given us oxygen, correct, no? Plants require carbon dioxide. Similarly, we are also taking sunlight. Sun's warmth is required for us, correct, no? Similarly, rainwater is potable, sweet water. The karapani from the ocean is converted into sweet water and given to us. See, there is no dearth of water. Ocean of water is there, but it's locked up by putting salt. But how do you get it? You do yajna, Lord is pleased, then he gives rains. When he gives rains, then he can drink sweet waters. Therefore, there is water scarcity now. Because people are turning away from God, there is water scarcity. You do yajna, worship God, then God supplies everything. So that is second category. What is the third category, sir? All the why Prabhupada said those metals names, like manganese, sulfur, all those things? They are available, but why he quoted that example? Anybody can guess? Now, how are you using them? You tell me. That also contains, but here when he's talking, he's not talking about that. He's talking about these things are taken by man from the nature. All these different. In Mendeley's periodic table, you have how many elements? 108 are. So the Mendeley's period, we have, so all these elements, including gold, silver, diamond, including iron, steel, manganese, and all these things. So why is he talking about them? That's the Prabhupada speaking for a very important reason. Anybody can guess? These are all building materials for the houses. Plus, these are the ones which are causing the industrial revolution. Can you have industries without these things? Like, for example, you have a silicon chip. Unless God gives you silicon, you can't make a silicon chip. Correct, no? So everything, these materials form the basis of the material civilization itself. Do you agree? Did man create any of these things, these three items? Therefore, if he is taking it from God and using, he becomes what? If he doesn't salute God and say thank you to God, he becomes? Yeah, like this light I am taking now. I am supposed to pay to MSEB, Maharashtra State Electricity Board. Correct, no? I buy a Bisleri bottle, I have to pay for it. In Delhi, Bangalore and all, even for a puff of air, you have to pay. You put a coin, you get air. Fresh air if you want. So for air, for food in a hotel, for drinking water bottle, for electric light, we are paying. Now sun is giving me so much light and heat. Am I paying? I am taking drinking water, which is potable water coming from the sky through rains God is giving. Am I paying to God? So, do you all agree that we are taking from God but not paying? Do you agree? Whether it is sunlight, moon. So, three items Prabhupada says very clearly. So, if anybody is taking these things, it's like imagine, say if this house is open now. There is a table in which all types of eatables are kept. Somebody passing by sees, hey, very nice. So many eatables are there. They just come into the house. They just eat everything, nice variety. And then they lie down in the bed. And then the person inside, you know, he has gone to bathroom, he comes out, suddenly he finds a fellow sleeping. And he sees that the table, whatever food he kept was all eaten up, and he's sleeping. What do you think he will do, tell me? He'll be kicked out, he'll be beaten up or not. Because the first thing is, who are you to commit barge into the house? That's what every human being is doing in this world. And they just, like I asked the boy, hey, why does lakhs of watermelons come in summer season? He said, Prabhuji, we are very thirsty now, therefore watermelons are coming. But then I asked, then who has created it? Somebody has created it. Like you have cooked a nice food and kept here, then somebody can come and eat it. Therefore in this world we should know we are taking things from God, but not thanking God. So thanking God is called yajna, acting for His pleasure. In this day and age, yajna is done by chanting Hare Krishna, which you all sang in the beginning. So you got an idea now? So in this way, we want to lord over the nature and want to control the other people. And like for example, God has given oil to the Gulf people. He has given dollar notes to the American people. But Americans want to take over Iran. And why they want to take over Iran? For oil. So one American big man, he was, in one article I read, he said to Gulf people, don't think this oil belongs to you. This oil belongs to God, he was telling. So that fellow wrote back saying that your dollar note also belongs to God only. So you give the dollar note and take the oil. Don't come and control us like this, bully us and take away the oil and run away. So one country, it's like mother, father sometimes give children some toys. Beta, you take a teddy bear. Beta, you take a tricycle. Beta, you take a bicycle. But some children are so naughty, they sit in the bicycle, they want a tricycle also, teddy bear also, and the other two brothers are asking, what are we supposed to do? You say, get lost. Same thing human being is doing, correct, no? So do you agree it's lording over? Bossing mentality. That bossing mentality can be seen in this world. See, life is temporary. One by one, everybody has to quit this world like this. Yeah, this I already told you before. Threefold miseries, I told you. Fourfold problems are that birth, old age, disease, and death. Correct, huh? Yeah. Actually, here we have shown this picture. Why? People who act sinfully in this world are like a naughty child who has left the safe custody of a millionaire parent. And sitting somewhere in some place alone and feeling loneliness. That is the story of Paradise Lost. You know, Milton wrote two books, Paradise Lost and Paradise Regained. So in Paradise Lost, what he says, one father had two sons, and the first son was a very well-behaved son. And the second son was little mischievous and naughty. He got spoiled by bad company. One day his friends told him, hey, your father is a millionaire. Why didn't you take your own share and enjoy life? So the boy said, that seems to be a good idea. I can eat, drink, and be merry. Why should I every time take permission from my father? He returned home, told Papa, divide the property and give me. I want to go to another place. And the father tried his best to explain, but everything fell in his deaf ears. Then the father wrote off his property. He got crores of rupees. Now his friends surrounded him. Friends liked the idea to be with him, and you know why. And they all took him, they drank, they smoked, they enjoyed life, and all the money was squandered away in misuse. When this fellow became bankrupt, they all left him alone. Now he went to one field where there was a jamindar. He begged for a job from him. Jamindar said, okay, you can take care of my 100 pigs. And here is a fodder for the pigs, like broken wheat. You can feed it to them, low-quality wheat, and you also can eat the same thing, he said. So this fellow became a keeper of the pigs, and he was doing the job. One day he was sitting like this and crying. Alas, I happen to be a son of a millionaire. Now look at my plight. I am now feeding the pigs and eating the same thing, which means I am eating like a pig only, what the pigs are eating. How nice my father was. Such a gentleman. He gave me so much love and affection. And then his mind changed. He felt, maybe I'll return back to him and meet him. I don't want to become his son again. After all, I have already taken my share. But I'll become his servant. It's better to be a servant of my father than to be a servant of this jamindar, eating all these dirty things. Thinking like that, he boarded towards his village. And when the village people went to his father and said, your second son who was lost, he's coming back. Immediately the father arranged for a bullock cart and took and personally fled to the frontiers of the village, got off the bullock cart and embraced his son, put him in the cart and tears in his eyes with great joy. So when he brought back, he told his elder son, I am so proud today that my younger son has come back. I feel so jolly. And the younger son was so flabbergasted, seeing, my lord, I took his share and went away, and see the way he behaves with me. Still he loves me, although I have turned away from him. So he cried tears also. And he told, Father, you please put me as a servant in your field, because I don't deserve to live in this home with you. Father said, no, beta, I always think you as my son. I don't treat you as a servant. So he lived with his father. So this comes in Bible also, the story. So this Paradise Lost story teaches. Now, any of you, what can you decode from this story for our life, if you can draw the analogy from this? In what context I told you this story? Anybody? He has answered many questions. We will not allow him now. We will give you an opportunity. Someone else can answer. Do you understand the story? Yeah. Now you have to draw the analogy. Why did I tell the story? How is it relevant to our spiritual lives?
Because we are like
Yeah, we are like which son, first or second son? Oh, correct. How did you find it? Yes. 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 Yeah, correct. Yes. But in what mood we want to return back to him? Do we want to be like his son? Oh, I just want to be your servant. We're ready. But God says, oh, you can be my friend. Like Krishna made Arjuna his friend. So like Hanuman becomes Lord Rama's servant. So they got very intimate company of God. One can get that. You all understand it? He captured it exactly. Very nice. Well done. Yeah. Actually, how aligning with God helps in material and spiritual problems? Both. Actually, for material problems, you have spiritual solution. This is answered. So what is the goal of life? You are not this material body, you are imperishable. So already you have learned that now, already. See, Krishna says this. Please repeat this sloka. Mamupetya punarjanma dukkhalayam ashashvatam napnuvanti mahatmanah samsiddhim paramam gataha. Please read the translation, somebody. Yeah, you have the mic with you? Yeah. Yes. After
attaining me, the great soul, who are yogis in devotion, never return to this temporary world, which is full of miseries because they have attained the highest perfection.
Lord Krishna says this. That means material world is dukkhalayam, uses the word. Dukkhalayam means, like pustakalayam means where there are books. Himalaya means where there is snow. Dukkhalayam means where people give dukkha to each other. And that is this world, he says. And it is ashashvatam, temporary. But those who come to spiritual world, they never return back. They always remain in spiritual world, he says. So, this I have already given the karanalogy earlier. We will go ahead with this. This is, like, why this example is given? Because this fellow is polishing the cage, but forgetting the bird inside. Similarly, people are forgetting the soul and just pampering the external body. For that, this example is given. Yeah. Actually, this one, I think it's Macaulay's, I think, let us see.
Early Indologists wish to control and convert the followers of Vedic culture. Therefore, they widely propagated that the Vedas were simply mythology. Max Müller, perhaps the most well-known early Sanskritist and Indologist, although later in life he glorified the Vedas, initially wrote that the Vedas were worse than savage, and India must be conquered again by education. Its religion is doomed. Thomas Macaulay, who introduced English education into India, wanted to make the residents into a race that was Indian in blood and color, but English in taste, in opinion, in morals, and in intellect. However, the German philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer stated that the Sanskrit understanding of these Indologists was like that of young schoolboys. These early Indologists devised the Aryan invasion theory, denying India's Vedic past. They taught that the English educational system is superior. They intentionally misinterpreted Sanskrit texts to make the Vedas look primitive. And they systematically tried to make Indians ashamed of their own culture. Thus, the actions of these Indologists seems to indicate that they were motivated by a racial bias.
Yeah. So their goal was to spread Christianity in India. That was their goal. So for that, they coined the new term called mythology. which means actually the Vedas, like the itihasa means history. Like Ramayana, Mahabharata, they're all itihasas, epics. But in this way, average Indian, his faith was destroyed. You will see that the British people left behind their style of their dressing, the style of their aspirations and everything. The smoking and drinking and coffee and tea, all these things came when British people came here. Their idea was to actually convert the whole country into Christianity, which they couldn't do, because Indians had a very deep-rooted faith in the culture of the Vedic life. So,
the Vedas are amongst the oldest religious scriptures known to mankind and are the source of India's spiritual and cultural heritage. At first glance, the multifaceted culture of the Vedas is a foreign and fascinating mystery to the Western eye. Yet upon deeper examination, we discover a wealth of philosophical, cultural, and social values. India is renowned the world over for the practice of yoga, which increases one's mental and physical strength. However, this is only a fraction of what the Vedas can offer to a progressive global community. India's culinary arts, music, natural medicine, and other sciences are only now becoming known to the West. Conceivably the world's oldest holistic design system, the Vastu Shastra predates and inspired the popular Chinese system of Feng Shui. The design of a temple, house, or workspace has been proven to exert a considerable influence on one's well-being. How specifically to address architectural guidelines?
So, has I can show many things like this.
Temples.
I will not show the full one. I will not show you. You will understand what is it mainly trying to convey.
Profoundly influenced the Greeks, Babylonian, and knowledge. Presented Indian.
See, in the Srimad Bhagavatam, this prediction about Buddha, Buddha's appearance in 563, the shloka number is given. You can see that, SB1324. It can be located. It's there in our Bhagavatam. Similarly, Chanakya's appearance is also mentioned in the Bhagavatam. Emperor Ashoka's. And this is from a part of Atharveda is called the Bhavishya Purana. It talks about Muhammad, it talks about Jesus who will appear later. And they will start their new religions, and that is also mentioned. Lord Chaitanya has predicted, all these things are predicted. So this is one interesting thing you will find. The future predictions made eventually became true. These are all predictions which were predicted long before, thousands of years before, and they have become true recently. And another example is, like for example, who is this fellow, J.C. Bose. Actually, plants have life. This is told in Shastra millions of years ago. Chara, achara word is used. Chara means, we are all called chara, and plants are called achara, non-moving living beings. Whereas scientists thought plants have no life. Recently it was proven. Similarly, the human embryology is given in the third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. There is a book called Cunningham Textbook of Anatomy. They have compared both Vedic embryology. First month, second month, third month, fourth month, up to 9 months, what happens in the mother's womb? That's predicted in the Bhagavatam. How we develop, and it exactly matches with the latest medical understanding. Similarly, cow dung's purity and products. Okay. So all these different things are given, Vedic mathematics, Ayurvedic, and these are all becoming understood all over the world as very deep wisdom. And actually, they give long enduring happiness and success. So if you accept axioms in science, then why can't you accept axioms in Vedas? For example, science, Heisenberg's uncertainty principle says you cannot simultaneously determine the velocity and position of an electron, correct, no? Then we accept it as an axiom. Like in mathematics, Euclidean geometry, you say that, a point is a no-dimensional entity. Then you go on to say a line is a set of points. If point has no dimension, how can line have a dimension? Then a plane is a set of lines. A solid is a set of planes. So we accept actions in maths, actions in thermodynamics, everything. Similarly, Vedas also, root of minus 1 is called what number? Imagined number. Nobody should ask what it is. But then the trigonometry is developed over this. If you see 2 plus 3i, and there are practical utilities of that, although the root of minus 1 you cannot find. In the same manner, the Vedic wisdom also has its axioms which are coming down in the four paramparas are given here, you see. So these are called Sri Sampradaya, Ramanujacharya, Brahma Madhava Sampradaya, in which ISKCON is coming, this one. And Rudra Sampradaya, Vishnu Swami, they are in Gujarat, you will find Pushtimarga and all that. And this is Kumara Sampradaya. So these are called as the four authorized disciplic chains, succession, where acharyas, one acharya gives knowledge, next, third, fourth, like electric pole is transmitting electricity, correct, no? Like that they have transmitted. It's an unbreakable line. How do you know the electricity is passed from one line to another? In your room, if you switch on the light, if light is on, you can know that connection is there, correct, no? Similarly, you will see that the line is operating even now and that people are becoming enlightened, correct, no? You can understand that. These are four sampradayas. This is Srila Prabhupada, about whom I have spoken several times to you. In his old age of 69 and 70, his, according to order of his guru, he went to the West, where he propagated the message of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam in a very powerful way. And you will know more, later on we'll show you a movie, you'll know more about him. And he created a revolution in knowledge all over the world. Yeah, about the Vedic knowledge. So, we have already exceeded the time. 4 o'clock I wanted to end. But one important thing I have not shown you, which is yoga for the modern age. Because we want to introduce chanting today, chanting of Hare Krishna, how we do that. I will not show you everything. Only few I will show you. Actually, the word yoga, anybody knows the meaning of the word yoga? Very close. You have come very close to the answer. Anybody else? Yeah? Yoga means, yoga comes from the word yuj. Yuj means to connect. Connect with God. So I told you in the lecture that we should do yajna in order to thank God for His pleasure. Now yajna, when you say immediately, you all think, maybe yajna kund is there, four brahmanas sitting, swaha, they are putting, correct, no? That is not the only yajna. Yajna actually means that which is done for the pleasure of God. So in this day and age, like here you see a yogi is meditating on God, that is also one type of yajna. They do all these things. 5,000 years before, Lord Krishna spoke about that Ashtanga Yoga to Arjuna, and Arjuna said, oh, going to Himalayas, sitting and doing meditation, it's impossible. He's saying, Arjuna is saying, my dear Krishna, mind is so turbulent, it's impossible to follow that. So in this way, this lecture shows many things, but here it says one important verse. Please repeat this. Krite yadhyayato Vishnu. Which means, in the age of Krita Yuga means Satya Yuga. Four Yugas you all know. Satya, Treta, Dvapara, Kali. In Satya Yuga, Dhyayato Vishnu. You have to meditate on Vishnu. Tretayam yajato makhai. In Treta Yuga, one should do yajna, offering ahati everything. Dvapare paricharyayam. In Dvapara Yuga, you should build big temples and perform deity worship. Deity worship means worshipping the murti form of the Lord. By Laksharchanas, hours and hours they would do worship in the Dvapara Yuga. Kalautad Harikirtanat. Kali Yuga, you have to do Harikirtan, which means chanting, japa. So for each age, one prescription is given, correct? So we are in which age now? Therefore, the Harikirtan is given here. Yeah, chanting. And you can see Christians also chant Hail Mary. Similarly, the Sikhs, they also chant Vaheguru. You have seen that? Satyanam, Satyanam, they sing like that if you go to that Gurudwaras. Muslims chant, they have rosaries, glass type of rosary they have. Rosary means like this, you know. They have, and they chant namaz, doing namaz, they also chant Allah's names. They have Buddhist chant Namo Abhida Butsu, they also have mantra. That means in all the religions, this type of softly chanting and attentively hearing, this procedure is there because it calms the mind, it strengthens the mind, it increases many qualities like tolerance. Similarly, in Sanatana Dharma also we have a mantra which we chant. I told you, man means mind, tra means delivers, and this is the mantra we chant. You all know it already. Many mantras are there, Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, or Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. In this age, this mantra is given by Brahma to Narada. See, here is a professor who has done his doctorate. He is saying that, Dr. Herbert Benson, he says that if you have a quiet environment and you sit in a comfortable position and you do a repetitive prayer of chanting and you keep a passive thought free from other thoughts, passive attitude, he says, what happens? Read this, what he says. During?
During meditation, the overall metabolism of the body slows markedly. For instance, heart and breathing rates decrease, blood flow to the muscle stabilizes, and blood pressure falls.
So this is called relaxed alertness. See, in tamoguna, people are fully relaxed, they don't do anything. In rajoguna, people are too much alert, hyperactive. Whereas in sattoguna, they are relaxed alertness. You combine these two and it becomes beneficial for you. And there are many, many quotes are given here, which I will not recite them. There are many, I'll give you this PPT. Ripal Prabhu will send you all. So here is chanting. So now we will learn how to chant Hare Krishna mantra. See, these are five personalities who taught this chanting all over India. They propagated. So we offer this first prayer to them. Please repeat. Sri Krishna Chaitanya, Prabhu Nityananda, Shri Advaita, Gadadhara, Shri Vasadi, Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. So the person in the middle is called Sri Krishna Chaitanya, and the blue one is called Nityananda. Then the extreme left is Advaita, and this is Gadadhara and Srivas. Adi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda, because they are the ones 500 years ago they descended and they propagated all over the country. We chant, and first of all pray to them, please bless me to chant attentively. And then when you are chanting, we should chant audibly. We should chant like this. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. At least you should be able to hear it. Don't chant in the mind. Some people try to chant in the mind and they go to sleep. If you chant too soft, we may go to sleep. Pronounce each name distinctly. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Like that, pronounce it. Don't say, like that you should not do. Some people hiss like a serpent, Prabhupada says. But we should pronounce it distinctly. Please repeat. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Krishna Krishna. Hare Hare. Hare Rama. Hare Rama. Rama Rama. Hare Hare. See, in Hindi when you write Rama, you say, Hare Ram. Hare Ram. Ram Ram. Hare Hare. People say, actually in Hindi you call it Ram. In Sanskrit it is Rama, you should say. Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Some people say it's actually Hare Krishna. Okay? So pronounce it distinctly. Three things should be involved. Your upper lip, lower lip and tongue. All the three should be involved. Chant with respect, devotion and concentration. So actually this mantra is addressed to God. O Lord Krishna, who is supremely attractive. O Lord Rama, who is supreme enjoyer. Oh, Hare, Hare is the energy of the Lord. I told you last time. Radha, Krishna, Sita, Ram, Lakshminarayan. Please, you know, help me to concentrate on the name. Please help me to come out of this world of varieties of sufferings. And take me up, take me back to your abode so that I can eternally serve you. And see, you can also chant in any place. You can sit and chant or walk and chant facing in any direction. But walking chanting is generally not appreciated because your concentration gets distracted. But while sitting, if you are dozing, better to get up and walk and chant. Okay. And any time of the day you can chant. Morning, afternoon, evening, night. Any time. But what is the best time to chant? Early morning. Brahma Muhurtam. The best time to chant. And in case you are not taken bath, can you chant? Yeah. Generally speaking, Vedic pujas and all cannot be done without taking bath. But chanting is an exception. Even without bath, you can chant also. That's allowed. You can do mantra snanam. Take some little 3-drop bath and say, Hare Krishna, you say. And then you can chant with your beads. So, yeah. And you see, some boys ask, Prabhuji, what is the need of counting God's name? Why not just, you know, kind of sing the holy name? Or, but why are we keeping count? Because one day our mind is in a good mood, it will chant. Another day we may not chant at all. So we want to do it in a regulated way. Just like you all go to company every day, correct? They kept a timing for you. Like in the morning, this time you come, you can go this time. Similarly, for chanting also, we keep a regulation. So that it's like everyday cleansing of our mind. I'm washing unwanted bad elements from our mind. Don'ts. See, what are the don'ts? One should not chant only a portion of the Maha Mantra. Full mantra you should chant. This is the way you should hold it. See, in the money you will find, this is called Guru Mani, this one. It's called Meru Mani or Guru Mani. Don't use this for chanting. Next to that, the first mani, you can, all of you show me, like this, you hold it, three fingers. Yeah. You show me? Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, correct.
And you should not count on this one. You begin from the next one with your thumb, like this. And then after finishing one mantra, you will push it down and touch the next one. Like for example, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And then you touch the next one. Hare Krishna, repeat. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare. Then you move it to the next one. Hare Krishna. So like this, if you keep on doing, when you come here, now how many have finished? 108. See, the 108 manis represent that you actually have mastered the 108 Upanishads. It's equivalent to studying them and becoming a master of them. Then mastering them, thoroughly understanding them. Another meaning of this is 108 prominent gopis of Krishna, who are the best devotees. So when you go through this full mala, you are taking blessings from all of them. And in this way, once you come here, you should not cross over. You should not do like this. What you should do? You should turn it around and then start this as the first one. Whatever you finish as last, that becomes first. And then again you go like this, go like this, go like this. After you finish this, should you cross? No. Again you turn it around and do like this. So like this, like this, like this, like this you go. Is it clear to everybody? So you can chant like this. One round takes you 108 manis to chant, takes you 10 to 12 minutes in the beginning. That's all. Any time of the day you can chant. Just chant one round. You try it. And see, while reading a book or watching TV and all, you cannot chant. One boy was saying, Prabhu Maharaj, chanting has become very easy ever since I started watching TV and chanting. Then where is the concentration? Isn't it? It's better to actually close the eyes and try to attentively hear the sound. Chant and hear. You have to hear that. No problem. You can see the mantra and chant also. Yeah, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Two words. You see and you hear initially. Slowly close the eyes and see the words in the eye of your mind. And chant. Gradually in the eye of the mind also you will not see. You will start hearing very nicely. Then hearing only will remain when you get concentration. Like a lens, you know. Initially you don't know where is the focal point. You keep doing like this. Gradually when the focus comes, you know, in that particular place small circle is formed. You put a paper or cotton, what happens? Oh, it can burn it. It gets such a power. So that focus and concentration gradually will come. Only hearing. And when you hear like that, That focuses on your heart and removes all the lust, anger, greed, everything. It burns it away. Yan nama shruti matrena puman bhavati nirmalaha, it says. Nirmal means purify. Purifies. Huh? Yeah, here are the benefits of chanting. Many people are saying here about how they benefited. Yeah. Students who were thinking, I am worthless, I am good for nothing, they developed self-esteem. This is from IIT students. See, Prabhupada made all the hippies into happies in America. I have a video of this also. You all have seen it? Yeah. See, here is scientific research. It says that below eight cycles per second, this is tamoguna. And above 13, rajoguna, red. And yellow strip is which one? I told you, relaxed, alert zone. So when you chant, gradually, when the concentration comes very nicely, you come to this yellow zone. So, but otherwise, you are angry like this or drowsy like this, he says. So beyond 21, people get heart attack and die. Similarly, below 3, a person becomes completely sleepy and inactive. So we want to be in the middle one. Actually, chanting brings you to your ever fresh zone, the yellow zone. You become free from all sinful activities also. By chanting, you get strength to say no to those gimme, you know. I told you 4 bad habits, they will all go away. It gives us relief from unwanted drives. Like, you know, when you walk in the outside world, sometimes there is a habit of watching in wrong directions. Unnecessarily, at somebody to whom we have no connection at all. Correct, no? So these type of lusty drives, angry drives, they all become nullified. See this fellow, what he says? Read it. We have a mic with you? I have 3-4 like this and then we'll conclude, yeah, yes?
Pleasant mood. If I start my day on a spiritual note by chanting Hare Krishna, I can make it through the day in a pleasant mood.
Yeah. Pleasant looking fellow. This is Toronto Health Spa proprietor Ramesh Lal. What he says? Yeah?
Peace of mind. Chanting Hare Krishna and reading authorized books on Krishna consciousness has brought me great peace.
Yeah. Here is a housewife lady. Let us see what she says.
Open the eyes of wisdom. Chanting has opened my eyes to things I never noticed. It's like beautiful music, a very peaceful feeling, very satisfying.
Yeah. See, these are all Western people. They have chanted and they have got immense benefit. See, he's a printing executive. All the time, busy fellow. What he says?
Stress relief. When I am stressed out, I chant. It's one thing which changes my battery.
It charges
my batteries. It clears my mind and brings me back in focus.
Just like when your mobile is discharged, there's only one stick or something, or it has become red, it's almost finished. It doesn't function well, correct? No? Similarly, we also, our brain gets heated up. Sometimes, therefore, if you didn't have enough sleep, you get angry, correct? No? Or if you get too much of workload, you get threatened by too much work and then you become irritable, correct? No? But when you chant, he says, it charges my battery and it helps me get focus. See, she's a merchandiser lady, what she's saying?
Mental stability. When I'm nervous, I find chanting very calming. I don't get shaken up at little things.
Yeah. When we have a low reserve of maturity, we get shaken up at little things. But chanting increases your maturity. He's an army officer. What he says? Bruce.
Positive thinking. My outlook towards life is a lot more brighter after starting to associate with Hare Krishna devotees and chanting Maha Mantra.
Yeah. He's a professor, Donald Tuck, from Western Kentucky University. Yeah.
I've noticed that as chanters progress from one level to deeper level, they become more realistic, more tolerant, and more energetic.
Amazing, no? Actually, this professor should give class on chanting to his friends, to students. He's saying that, you know what is the meaning of realistic? They are not hovering in the clouds, you know. They are realistic people. They are not in the dream world, like the teenagers are nowadays. And they also become more tolerant, which is very necessary nowadays. Nowadays I see somebody want to cross the road and the people want to go in the car fast. Both want to go. You've seen that? So we need to be more tolerant and more energetic. George Harrison. Yes?
it's really a process of having realization of God.
Yes. Yes. Jai Shri Prabhupada ki jai. So we are completed, you all know it now. And Vipul Prabhu, he will chant with all of you in Zoom. Huh? You know Zoom, this one? It's like it's a software which is easily downloadable, and Skype also is there, but we generally connect in meetings through Zoom. Any of you have Zoom in your computer? You have? So, mobile they have it. Zoom is there, mobile also?
Yes, please.
Oh, okay. So, you can chant at a time convenient to all of you. Just chant one round, whatever time, morning or night or whatever time, but try to hear. Till now, you have heard four sessions of... Now, I will just chant with all of you. 10 times only I'll chant. Then you will get an idea how do we chant. Together we chant. If you want, you can use the mala. Just 10 counts we will do. Please repeat. Sri Krishna Chaitanya. Prabhu Nityananda. Shri Advaita. Gadadhara. Srivas, Adi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Now together we are going to chant, okay? And 10 times we'll chant. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So you all got it now? It's not very difficult. And you just do one mala a day for about 10-12 minutes for 1 week. And next week you can tell us how you felt in this 1 week. Even in a week, you feel a lot of difference. It will be very calming to your mind and gives a very pleasant feeling. Because as I told you, that Paradise Lost story, the boy returned back to his father. So this is actually the way to go back to the spiritual world, by chanting this. It's actually a prayer. Oh Lord, please forgive me for forgetting you and turning away, please, you know, help me to approach you and love you and serve you, you know? That is a prayer actually. So, in today's session, because I covered 3 things today. One was about the human life versus animal life, correct, no? A human life means that should be dharma. And then I covered about 2 questions which you can ask in human life. What are the 2 questions? Goal of life? And why am I suffering? Correct, no? Then while elaborating that, I told you about 3 types of sufferings, which is Durga, you know, places. But in this material world, Durga and Shiva are the leaders in this world. They are actually in charge of the material world. In charge of spiritual world is Lakshmi Narayan, Sita Ram, and Radha Krishna. So what are they having in their hand? Have you ever seen Lakshmi or Radharani or Sita holding a Trishul? What are they holding? Lotus, correct. Padma Alankrita Pani Pallavi Yugam Padma Sanastam Shriyam. She is holding a lotus. Now there she is holding lotus, that Shakti, whereas this Shakti here is holding a Trishul. Why? Because material world is like a jail. In jail one gets punishment. But when you come out and live as a law abider, the law abiders are given all benefits by the Prime Minister. Whereas in the jail, we are given punishments.
Correct, no?
For law abiders, there is no punishment. Correct? Similarly, in the spiritual world, the Shakti, Devi, Radharani, Lakshmi or Sita, they are welcoming you with a lotus. Just like you go to some meeting, do they give you a bouquet in hand? Bouquet means a flower bunch. Or do they show a trishul on your face? Why they give a flower bunch? Because it's a sign of respect and welcome. So spiritual world, we are being welcomed. My dear child, come back. Be lead a very happy life there. That is real world. And this material world is a temporary